Hi, everybody. This is Dino Chris from Prehistoric Facts. Since today was supposed to be an answer questions episode, so no questions came in today. No questions came in for this episode, but I'll actually talk about the topic this time. And just like the past couple ones that I've actually have done for answering questions, and this topic would actually be covering the geologic time scale. Now, what the geologic time scale actually is what geologists use to actually look at the date of the Earth. And it's basically looking at rock formations, mostly. When you look at rock formations, you're actually looking at pages of a book of the Earth's history. And so you actually go from today all the way down to 4.6 billion years ago. So that is actually a long time to actually look at the Earth's history. And we'll actually go from old to the young here. So we'll actually start out with the Hadean period, which is basically the beginning of the Earth. And so the beginning of the Earth is actually just basically you have the Earth forming, basically in terms of rocks, clustering together, basically creating this creating a form of a spherical type of body, rock body would actually become a planet. And so when the Earth was actually formed, it was actually basically very hot rock, and also the atmosphere was still kind of developing, so it was actually during a time it was basically really not a really good time to actually live, especially if you put a human in the Hadean, you would actually the human wouldn't even survive for at least 3 seconds. So that would actually it would actually be very volatile to live at that time. But also an important thing actually happened during this time, and this was actually what is actually considered to be the impact theory is that another body actually has hit the Earth and basically kind of colliding with Earth, and then basically the Earth is starting to reform from this impact. And also the part of the body that was actually left behind from that other body was actually kind of left into the Earth's gravitational pull, and basically what actually happens is that it actually stays near the Earth, and then all of a sudden you get other rocks forming to actually form a smaller type of body, which created the Moon. And so that actually was actually the reason why probably how the Moon has formed, and also possibly how our atmosphere got to this way, and also how the rocks are actually going to be important into this part of the era. But then after the Hadean, you get to the Archean period, and the Archean period is when the Earth is actually the Archean era, I should say era. The Archean era is actually a point in time where basically the Earth is still developing, and it's developing its oceans, it's developing the continents, and so the continents would start to form. And what you're actually going to get is actually basically volcanoes just erupting like crazy. It would be like living in hell, mostly from most of that time. And see, the atmosphere is so poor in oxygen, so it was actually more common carbon dioxide, some nitrogen, and all those sorts of gases that would actually not be very good for breathing, considering that we need oxygen in order to actually survive in this kind of world. But even though not all life forms need oxygen, but since life forms didn't really start to begin until the end of the Archean era, so it would actually be around near the end of the Archean is when we start to see the first single cell life forms, which is basically your first single cell forms that are living in the oceans mostly, and they're actually producing this kind of ecosystem for the kind of like almost the first ecosystem a little bit. And so that actually, and then we get to the Proterozoic era, and that actually, or eon basically, but mainly era. But when we actually look into the Proterozoic, means when Proterozoic means before life, and but even though life was actually starting to actually actually starting to develop. And so when we actually look at that time, then the single cell life forms start to become multicellular life forms. And so that was when we had to start to see multicellular cellular organisms. And this is actually called the Precambrian, basically, because the Archaean and the Proterozoic is actually the Precambrian. And so the Precambrian is actually, you got some weird things going on during this time in the Earth. And during the Proterozoic is when we start to have to see Snowball Earth. And Snowball Earth is basically when the great oxidation period in the Earth's history was basically when oxygen was starting to develop. And that was when we actually start to see a form of rock called the banded iron formations, or otherwise known as BIF. And so it actually has started to create this oxygen. The atmosphere start to create this oxygen. And so when you actually build up more oxygen, you start to cool the planet. And so that actually has, when you cool the planet, then basically ice actually forms in the poles. And then basically the ice keeps growing and growing and growing and growing, and basically covers nearly the entire Earth. And so Earth would actually just look like a giant snowball. And so if we were on the moon during that time, we'd be looking at Earth as basically like this white ball, basically, kind of like almost like a golf ball, you know, like a giant golf ball in a way, because it would actually just be almost white. There'd be certain spots where you can actually see some parts of the continents, and you see there start to see some terrestrial bacterial life actually start to form. And that's why you hear a lot of evidence support that during Snowball Earth, that some bacteria that was actually living in the ice, living in this kind of conditions, were actually kind of developing to actually be part of that part of that kind of lifestyle. But then when you actually get to a period after Snowball Earth, is then we actually start to see some life forms that almost have bodies, basically. And these would actually be more invertebrates. The vertebrates were not even around at that time. But we actually kind of start to see like some forms that probably might actually start to become vertebrates. And so that actually has a big factor into that. And that's why the fossil record is actually very important to the geologic time scale. Yeah. Is that you need to know what life forms were actually around during these particular times. And so bacterial colonies are very important, and also some of the invertebrates are very important. You start to see some forms of the first jellyfish and some life forms that almost look like trilobites, but even though they probably could become trilobites. But now you get to the Phanerozoic, which is basically the stage of the eon that is actually the beginning of, is basically life, is where life diversified rapidly. And so that's when we actually start to actually go into the Cambrian. And the Cambrian is very important in terms of the fossil record. It's because, you see, it's some of the rock formations that make up the Cambrian have a diverse ecosystem. We actually see trilobites. We actually see some invertebrates that are so alien that we would actually think of this like, where did these come from? Like, we would have Anomalocaris, you know, and, you know, of course, like I mentioned, the trilobites, the first vertebrates actually didn't really start to come around until the late Cambrian. So the late Cambrian was actually part of where you start to see like the first vertebrate-like fish. And so these kinds of fish didn't really have jaws. There were no such thing. There was no such thing as jaws. And there was that in terms of vertebrates and invertebrates. So it was actually more of an opening, kind of like a suction cup, basically. And they would probably use that for feeding, basically. They were probably carnivorous most of the time, but even some of them were probably carnivorous, probably feeding on some of the flesh that's been actually been eaten by some of the, that was actually eaten, probably some leftovers from some large predators like Anomalocaris or otherwise they were like basically bottom feeder suckers. So basically they just suck up all the algae and the waste and the minerals that were actually on the ocean floor, and so they were at the bottom of the food chain at that point. Then when you get to the Ordovician and the Silurian, that was when, you get to the Ordovician and the Silurian. In the Ordovician, you actually start to see some diversification in terms of shelled creatures like nautiloids and coil nautiloids. And trilobites are still around. They were actually kind of almost in decline at that point. And they were kind of beginning to decline near the end of the Ordovician. And so that's when you start to see that new predators were coming in. And so that was actually a big part of it. And also the Ordovician extinction actually kind of happened. And then basically when you get to the Silurian, some of the straight cone nautiloids start to shrink in size. So they would probably basically be the length of a car, basically a small car. And then they actually get to the nasties of all nasties in terms of invertebrates, and that would be the Eurypterids. And the Eurypterids, in my opinion, are the nasties of the nasties in terms of the arthropod family. And so these are kind of ancestors to lobster, some scorpions, and spiders. But basically, they're kind of more commonly related to like crustacean type of creatures like lobsters and crab, you know, those sorts of things, and also horseshoe crabs. And you see, those are actually really common in the Silurian. But then when you get to the Devonian, that was when you actually start to see some large Eurypterids actually kind of start to come around. But also, fish diversified in the Devonian, and that was when you start to see all the jawed fish. And the jawed fish took over in the Devonian. And that's why the Devonian is actually named the Age of Fish. And so fish were actually diversifying rapidly. And you start to see fish actually start to have strong front limbs. And also they were starting to develop strong back limbs. And that is the beginning of actually starting to see limbs. The first ever limbs to possibly be strong enough to be able to lift on land, to be able to walk, and the missing link of that is Tiktaalik, and Tiktaalik is kind of an amphibious type of fish. It's technically a fish, but even though it's actually kind of like in between of a fish and an amphibian, and you see, we still don't know if it really did have lungs, but there's a possibility it did, and it probably have a rib cage to suggest that it probably did actually breathe on land, so it probably will only walk on land for a short period of time. It would not actually be walking on land for a long distance, and also need to be near water in order for it to actually be walking around. But anyway, let me fast forward very quickly here, and we actually start to go into the Carboniferous and the Permian. In the Carboniferous, we actually start to see large arthropods taking over in the land, which is then you actually start to see the great a very big boost in oxygen, and that's why the arthropods got bigger. And then amphibians were actually very common in the Carboniferous, and also you start to see some small reptiles. The first ever reptiles were actually starting to come around in the Carboniferous. But then when you get to the Permian, that was when you actually start to see the age of reptiles actually come around. And it's when you start to see the sailback type of reptiles like Dimetrodon. And also you start to see these kinds of weird reptiles that are actually starting to almost look like mammals. And you see that's why they're actually called mammal-like reptiles. Some of them were actually called proto-mammals. And so these were actually reptiles that were actually starting to show the features of mammals. And they're called synapsids. And synapsids means there's basically about the back part of the skull. And it is one synapsid means one opening. One opening in the back of the skull. And that's why us humans are mammals, and mammals are synapsids. That's because we have one hole in the back of our skull, and that's basically right where our ears are actually are, and basically that's where our one hole in the back of the skull is. But also there's another type of kinds of reptiles that are actually kind of starting to come around, as are the diapsids. And the diapsids were actually kind of like a medium way in the food chain, so they were actually kind of starting to get big, but even though they weren't getting as big as like what the mammal-like reptiles were actually doing. But then you have the mother of all extinctions, the Permian extinction, which wiped out nearly 90% of all life on Earth. And so that actually had a great effect on the Earth. But then you get to the Mesozoic era, and that is basically what everybody knows is the age of is the era of dinosaurs. But basically dinosaurs didn't start to develop until the Triassic period, around 230 million years. So there's a big gap of where dinosaurs actually kind of developed. But you get these archosaurian type of reptiles that are really developing in the Triassic, and the Triassic is the archosaurian period, and that's why dinosaurs never really ruled the Earth until the end of the Triassic. And that's when you start to see dinosaurs actually start to diversify a little bit more, and you see Pangaea was still actually kind of around in the Triassic, and then you actually have that kind of extinction where basically Pangaea was breaking up, and that's what was kind of the volcanic activity actually kind of caused some of that extinction. And then get into the Jurassic and the Cretaceous, and that was when dinosaurs really diversified, and also they actually took over on land. Now dinosaurs are land animals. They're not airborne animals. Well, I'm kind of wrong on airborne, but even though we have airborne dinosaurs today, and they're called birds, but they don't actually live in the sea or anything like that. That's because you see reptiles took over those reigns. That's why you got the pterosaurs, which are flying reptiles, and also you got numerous marine reptiles that actually took over the oceans, and they took over the oceans in the Triassic. And I mean, it's amazing of how many marine reptiles there are. And then in the Cretaceous, it was when he actually had the second largest extinction in Earth's history, is the KPG extinction. And so that is actually an asteroid or some volcanic activity has actually caused some of that extinction. But then you get to the era that we're actually in, and that's the Cenozoic. And the Cenozoic is actually known as the Age of Mammals. And you see, mammals really didn't really start to get large until the Eocene. Because you see, in the Paleogene, or the Paleocene, the Paleogene, reptiles were still actually dominating, but basically it was mainly crocodiles and giant snakes. Mammals were still small at that point, and then when you actually have the diversification in the late Eocene and the Oligocene, that was when you actually start to see some weird looking mammals like the entelodonts, the creodonts, you know, all those weird predatory mammals. But then you actually have some pretty cool looking plant eating mammals as well, like the first rhinos. So you get the first horses. You actually have all these kinds of mammals that actually that we know today are actually kind of, they start out small, but then they actually got bigger as time went on. And then when you have the Miocene and the Pliocene, that was when mammals really got large, and that was when you actually start to see some big diversification in terms of what kinds of species of mammals actually started to develop. It's when the Pliocene, you start to see some really cool looking creatures. And then you actually have the Pleistocene, which is the Ice Age. Everybody knows this is the Ice Age. And you actually have the mammoths, the mastodons, the giant American bison. And then you actually have the giant short-faced bear. You got some of the cave bears. You got the cave lions. You got the cave hyenas. You got some camels, all sorts of stuff. And the giant ground sloths as well. So that was when you actually have those kinds of animals that are actually roaming around during that time. And then we're actually in the Quaternary right now. Not actually in the Quaternary, but even though that was part of the Pleistocene. But we're in the Holocene, which is basically the age of humans. So humans actually took over a lot more after 10,000 years. And that was after 10,000 years ago, and that was basically when we start to see the diversification of humans taking over the world and basically living in different parts of the planet, and that's where we are today. And possibly we're actually moving into a new period, a new type of period or eon or somewhere, basically a new period or an epoch, basically new epoch. So, see what happens. And the geologic time scale will still continue to grow, no matter what happens, especially if we find new rock layers that we still haven't actually found yet. And that's basically what's actually going to be happening, is that the geologic time scale will still grow. And so, looking into the fossil index, and all sorts of minerals and rocks, and you get to find out what more things are about to come. All right, that's it for now, and next week will be a special episode. So I'll put up the link of what dinosaurs, put up the link of the list of dinosaurs, and you can choose a dinosaur or two that you want me to talk about, and can talk about it on the next week's episode. So, but also, you can still send me questions at any time. And so you can still send me questions by emailing me at dinochris71@gmail.com, or other ways you can actually go on the Facebook page, Prehistoric Facts of Dino Chris, like the page, and you can also post the questions in the comments section on any Facebook post. Remember, keep your questions short and to the point. And you can also follow me on Twitter at CSGRALL. That's my Twitter page. And follow me there, and I actually post pretty cool stuff there. And also, take care of the people around you, and also for you younger people out there, make sure to listen to your parents, your teachers, and your guardians. Those are the best motivation you can have for a good education. It's very important to have a good education, because with a good education, you get a good job in the future. All right, that's it for now, and I'll see you guys next week.